Hello everybody, my name is Joan Curós Vilà. I am an architect doctor and professor of design in UPC, Barcelona Tech. My presentation is about architecture without architects in Catalonia, Spain, from the structuring of the rural territory to oblivion. My presentation is structured by three parts. The first, introduction, kind of landscape, kind of rural house, kind of rural building, and the intervention about the heritage, respect with the architecture, and the intervention in the landscape, continuity, natural needs with the landscape. The second part is characteristics of landscape, like topography, geometry, water zones, reflex. And the end part, the last part, is the rural architecture, the main characteristics, cohesion, and the intervention like permeability, mirror effect, and limits. Inside the limits, two parts, continuous visuals and discontinuous visuals. The first part, introduction, we can be different types of landscapes. The landscape is classified by types which have very different characteristics among them that condition and link the type of architecture that is built on it. The main determining factors are topography and geometry. Natural phenomena such as rivers, ditches, rough canals, lakes, roads, parcels are decisive when it comes to configuring, supporting and harmonizing the geometry of a landscape, often forming a chromatic mosaic. The range of colors is linked to a dry or humid climate where it is characterized by its intensity or palidness. The other factor is the altimetric levels, where the areas are completely horizontal or inclined planes, through terraces that articulate the different levels. Next, it's types of rural house. In Catalonia, there are seven types of rural dwellings, masías, according to their exterior morphology. One of its most decisive elements in the classification is the type of roof and the orientation of its shares. There is a direct link with the size of the farmhouse and the place where it is located. The greater the productivity of the land, the greater the capacity of the house, and the greater the majesty. For example, there are gable roofs where they flow through the main and rear facade, which are usually short distance homes located on the mountain. The most common when the shore slopes drain through the lateral facades that are usually built on the plains. The foresight typology is the least frequent with large building with a stately appearance. There are those of the coast with a tower and of the basilica type where the central body acquires more height. Finally, those of the Penedès that are close structures and the colonial one. Types of rural buildings. There are seven types of rural buildings that complement rural dwellings, masías. They are all very different depending on the landscape area where they are located, whether it's in the mountains such as the huts or the chaparrals, cabins on the plain such as the porch or cabins, and in delta areas, such as the Valencian hood or the masets in the windward growing areas. There are windward hoods. All of them are isolated constructions, but the porch or cabins are located very close to the farmhouse, which form a unity set for agricultural and livestock development. In some area of the coast, there is some reminiscence of hoods for fishermen. Many of these buildings no longer maintain their original use, but some of them have been transformed into housing. Next is respect with the rural architecture. Respect in architecture is essential both in its context and in the architecture itself. Architecture has a language that it's necessary to analyze prior to any type of intervention that one wants to practice in it. The more sensitive the place is, the more this respect must be accentuated towards the landscape itself and its architecture. Many times, this respect disappears or is reduced by the urban and speculative hygienics that is implemented in different cities or urban locales and in their peripheries. Vernacular architecture entails in its surrounding a natural landscape free to be urbanized with which the dialogue of the architecture itself is projected in its context. This architecture contains a deeply rooted relationships with its exterior, both at the level of internal organization and also exterior between the different buildings of the complex. Some circulations, some visuals, some empty space, a proportions, some excess, that unitarily configure the balance of both architecture as well as the landscape that sustains it, with which is not possible to attempt against this wisdom of men embodied in the balance that is projected inside rural territory. In many places, unfortunately, important rural buildings have been demolished due to the expansion of urban areas, densifying the place and turning it into a banality without any type of urban or architectural interest. In other situations, it becomes an anecdote and contempt for existing rural architecture, invading its free space with new buildings that are out of scale and inappropriate use with the place. About the landscape, continuing natural needs with the landscape. The landscape speaks and the architecture listens, with which a silenced dialogue is generated. Vernacular architecture is born from the landscape itself. It is that provides the topography, the materials, the proportions, the roads, the articulations between interior and exterior. Vernacular architecture caresses the landscape and does not attack it. It gives him the leading role and never imposes itself on him. Vernacular architecture does not interrupt the landscape, but rather follows it trace in a natural way and both merge, acquiring unity. The scale and landscape balance is always very present in rural architecture. The results on an architecture without architects, simple the results of the experience and chronology of the place of those who built it. The second part, the landscape, the characteristics, the first, is topography. Topography is the essential parameter of the landscape which determines the decisions to be made when building small support elements that are part of it or the architecture itself, when it can become an artificial topography that gives continuity to the natural topography. You can see examples which work in topography in China, this one in Spain, and then geometry. The geometry in the landscape is the structure that formalizes a mosaic throughout the division heightic by the chromatism of the different crops. The main structures are the natural ones of the territory itself, such as roads, river feeds, canals or ditch. The build up areas they make up the main lines of this grid mosaic that acquires its own character, which is linked in the type of territory, in the climate of the place, and in the geographical accidents existing in it. Following, you can see another examples. This building is situation in two parts, the main building in the right, the secondary building in the left, but separate the line of the way between two fields in every side. Another image is a clear geometry in this way. Tree, pavement, and the next characteristic is the water, water zones reflex. Water is an element with a notable impact on the landscape, above all nutritive, but also visually as the beautifier of it. For visual purpose, it reflects the closed context in its own water plane, whether geographical feature such as mountains, trees, buildings, or any element that allows it to be captured from said surface, showing an unreal image, but a great beauty for the landscape itself. An example, we can see a small swimming pool, which reflects a part of the building during the day and during the night. The last part is the rural architecture. Cohesion, the main characteristic between architecture and landscape. One of the characteristics of vernacular architecture is its cohesion with the landscape, its integrity with the laws that it indicates. It's an architecture that adds to its context due to its great respect for proportions, the materials always linked to the territory. A totally sustainable architecture given the great use of atmospheric agents, such as the sun that nourishes its interior rooms, cross ventilation, the amount of natural light in the rooms that need in most of the building in landscape with terrace, where rooms such as the warehouse or a space where a constant temperature is maintained without altering the interior temperature due to external atmospheric agents. Another virtue of this architecture is the functional pragmatism of its interior organization. The noblest rooms are usually oriented to the south, the living room and the bedrooms, and the service areas such as the kitchen and the sanitary chamber to the north. The facade with the largest opening is the main facade facing south, and the blindest and with the smallest windows is the north facade. Regarding its situation with the landscape, the access is usually oriented frontally with respect to its main facade, with which, depending on the purchasing power of the owners, the most notable finishes of the building are exhibited. About the intervention, one main characteristic is the permeability. The permeability in architecture is a factor introduced in modern architecture, wherein vernacular architecture it was not frequent or common to interact the interior space with the exterior, unless so in the ground floors of the house that used to be the stables for the animals. In the contemporary interventions of rural buildings, it's interesting to consider this concept for the mere for or being able to enjoy the wonderful natural landscape from the interior space of the house and simultaneously their new facade adquired a secondary aspect without there being any pretense of invalidating or reduce the prominence of the original facade of the building whose main materials is the stone of the area with which in certain interventions this permeability enhanced the importance of the original facade throughout its projection. Another factor is construction near or on the water, mirror effect. When building in highly sensitive landscape areas or areas of great natural interest, the intervention must cause the highest impact on the site. For this, a lot of thought must be given to the use of the materials that are going to be used in the facade, so they enhance the landscape and the architecture does not represent an attack on the context. One possibility is that the volume is a projection of the landscape itself and not an interruption of it. In this way, the architecture will be integrated in such a way that it will remain unnoticed in the landscape setting itself. This is a possibility of converting architecture into landscape and landscape into architecture, thus obtaining an optimal unit in a new construction. The last concept is limits. The physical limits of architecture often transcend the building itself and it's the exterior space called the garden, a transition space that become the exterior limits which interact with the landscape itself. These limits indicate the local enclosed, the private property with which on certain occasions the visual exceeded these physical limits or other times the visual collided with the limits themselves. Depending on each case, if the limits are horizontal or vertical, they may unconsciously disappear or may be very present through the exterior of the property, except for very specific points that are intended to come into play with the existing landscape after the limits. In first point inside the limits is limits with continuous visuals. The horizontal limits have a very reduced perception and impact with the obstruction, the surrounding landscape of the property of the enclosed, which generates an imaginary disappearance of them. This leads to enjoying fictitious limits with the same function of framing a territory with a great variety of natural settings that widen the physical limits. These new horizons, not limits, create a poetics and a plasticity that extols the architectural discourse of the building itself both in the depth of the visuals, in the landscape chromatism, in the natural forms, in the proportions. And next typology is limits with discount visuals. When a certain amount of privacy is needed or the scenarios behind the limits of a property are not of interest, it's necessary to raise some vertical limits so that they become part of the scenario itself and fragment with the unwanted. These limits have an absolute impact on creating a new landscape and isolating it from the limitless landscape. It's worth an exhaustive reflection on how this new venue should be so that it's visually interesting and not boring. This does not mean that it must be continuous, close or opaque throughout its entire length, but rather that caution must be exercised in analyzing the entire perimeter in case there is any part of it that can provide added perceptual value from inside the building. Properly to delimit be its depth, chromatism, scale with which unique and interesting points are created throughout the enclosure. Thank you very much for your attention.